You're next in line for the official Holiday World Podcast.
Welcome to Holiday World and Splashin' Safari.
Dropping in from Santa Claus, Indiana.
Riders will experience swift acceleration, high-speed turns, and sudden stops.
With Park President and CEO, Matt Eckert.
We're trying to keep our podcast short, remember?
Fourth-generation owners, Lauren Crosby.
We've been through this in the last episode.
And Director of Communications, Leah Cook.
Some things will stay around forever.
Now stow your loose articles, buckle up.
And please keep your hands and legs inside the car at all times.
And we're back. Welcome back to season two of the official Holiday World podcast. This is season two, episode 25, the one where a star is born, but this time not sad. Today's Friday, November 6th for us, but we expect to release this episode November 23rd.
Actually soon.
Yeah, I know. This is like
this month.
Oh, this episode's actually happening this year.
Yeah, so this is the first of the episodes that's going to be a release that we're recording today. So for those of you listening at home, I literally wrote in a disclaimer to the script. And it says, in order to coordinate all the special guests we have joining us this recording day, we had to record completely out of order. We're doing our best today to keep the past and future straight, but please bear with us. We're doing a terrible job. For the record, we're already mixing things up. But this is the first. So, guys, sorry. You're in for a wild ride for the next four episodes after this. But, you know, we're going to have some fun along the way. So, anyway, I want to welcome back Matt B., Sabrina,
Hello.
Lauren.
I'm here.
Welcome.
I heard about some feedback.
There's some feedback coming up in several episodes that...
I'm here. I exist. Rude.
Which said, who are these voices? Matt, Lauren, is that you? Because Matt Ecker also hasn't been on. He was supposed to be here today. He wasn't feeling well today.
Oh, okay.
So.
There's a new Matt in town.
Yep. Yeah.
And I also don't like birds. So yeah.
Literally, I have my alts list now, and it's normally I bring in Sabrina when you're out, Lauren.
Fair.
And I bring
Matt B. She does have a mom voice. So.
Yeah. And I bring Matt B in when Matt E is out. So
solid.
That's what we do. All right. We also have, I'm going to start with Sandy Fortune, also known as just Fortune. Sandy, tell
Hello.
Us about your history with Holiday World. And yeah.
Oh, wow. It's a long history of Holiday World. I started at Holiday World when I was 15 years old.
Oh.
Probably the youngest entertainer hired in live shows.
Wow.
I was hired as an alternate and got thrown into the shows that year. Lori's like, hey, guess what? Surprise.
Also, actually by the way, my mom, Lori, is here. So
hello.
That's her voice.
And then I worked for the park for 4 years. And then I went away and did some other things, cruise ships
Lots
and
of things.
Such, and traveled the world for a while. And when I came back, I started teaching at the high school and got to hang out with Lauren and Leah in school.
She was my teacher.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
She invited me to her birthday parties.
I did. I'm the coolest kid in the world. We all knew that.
And then a few years later, Will and Matt Eckert called me in and said, hey, how would you like to come back and work at the park? And I said, you know, I'm a teacher, like all year. And they're like, yeah, we'll take what you can give us. So I came back in as director of entertainment 13 years ago when I was on maternity leave with Alicia. So that's when I can remember how long that was.
Wow.
And I did that for about 10 years, right under 10 years, I think.
Mm-hmm.
It's been about 4 years almost. That, and then now I'm working with Lauren. Lauren's director of entertainment now, and I work along with her doing things in the park still. But
love it.
Yeah,
she's so underselling herself. She helps produce shows for us,
clutch.
And she. But she not only is that, she's also our I'm not coming up with a good analogy because I want to say our emotional support dog. That underplays what Sandy is.
She's our emotional support fortune.
She literally she's very mothering and just nurturing. And if you ask any past performer, they're going to, during Sandy's time, they're going to be oh my gosh, Sandy is my second mother. I love her. She will always have my heart. I mean, that's who.
Yeah.
Yes. So
I love it. Yeah, but yes, even still, Sandy sometimes gets brought in because Lauren is not always good with the touchy-feely.
I'm getting a little better.
So much better.
She is.
I'm so proud of her.
But yeah, you used to be that, like, Lauren with entertainment. Like
cold and distant, yes.
Let's be honest, entertainment tends to be a dramatic crew. And so when things would happen, Lauren would be like, yes, Sandy, it's your turn.
Because I would want to go into the dressing room and be like, and just suck it up, put a smile on your face, and go do the show.
Do a show.
They didn't want to hear that. They didn't want to hear that.
All right, Mom, you've been on fairly recently, but I don't know if you've been on since I started hosting.
No, I have not.
Welcome. If you could add, I didn't ask Sandy yet. Mm. I'll put the question out, but first of all, tell us about your history with the park.
Well, I've said it before, but
it's also the history of our family.
Yes. I was hired to be in the shows back in 1983. Met Will Cook, and by the end of my first summer, we were dating. I came back in 1984 for my second summer, and we broke up, and then got back together. He proposed at Thanksgiving. We got married in 85 and lived in California for a couple years. And then we returned to the park in Christmas of 86. So 1987. And
the rest is history.
The rest is history. I was director of entertainment for probably about 13 years. Mm-hmm. Had three babies and... came a point
you'll,
where
you'll
I needed to
find out in a couple
up.
Episodes just how big those babies were.
Exactly.
I'm not told Mel about it. It's fine.
So, but needless to say, there came a point where I needed to stay home and be a stay-at-home mom. Mm-hmm. Somebody needed to be around for the kids, and
someone had to raise them.
Will was busy with the park in the summertime, so I bowed out and went and stayed with the kids, and don't regret it. And
we were a full-time job.
We were involved in a lot of things, which, yes. But weirdly, compared to kids now, I feel like we were involved in nothing. So
I know, compared to like the Fortune kids,
seriously,
I feel like
I just sat on the couch all day.
I feel like every time I text Sandy, she's like, "Yep, just between things. Like, what do you need?" Okay, so I'm gonna start with the icebreaker question, then we're gonna get into why we're here. So, Sandy, if you could add one attraction or section to the park, what would it be and why?
My section that I would add to the park would be New Year's Eve.
Ooh. Yes.
Because it would have lots of sparkle, lots of confetti, and a gigantic theater.
I love it.
Nice.
Fair. For the record, that was my answer too.
Really?
I have been gunning for a New Year's section since my dad was like, what section should we add back in 2005 whenever he was brainstorming? Yeah. And I said, New Year's. And he said, no.
Yep.
I have been saying since you were probably 12 that you were really secretly my daughter.
This is true. That's amazing. Yeah. I also am on the New Year's bandwagon, but
should have been New Year's. Mm-hmm. Not Thanksgiving.
What a party.
Yeah.
I know.
It would be so fun.
It would be.
Party every day.
That's right.
Every day is a holiday. You could have like a nice like concert style show, like the New Year's ball drop.
Oh, yeah.
I'm just saying.
Yeah.
New Year's Rockin' Eve, whatever.
End of the night. Yeah. The ball drops every night.
Yeah, that would be awesome.
I'm imagining like a glitter curtain. I'm rolling now.
Yeah. I just heard like our cleaning department director. I think I just heard her head explode from miles away.
However, you can make that glitter effect with a water wall too.
Ooh.
Nice. Just saying.
Or we can get those. What is it,
I'm picturing the fireless like cannons every day.
The fireless fireworks, the sparkular.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. I'm here.
A good plan here now.
All right, Mom, same question.
I think you know what I'm going to say.
I'm trying to...
Birthday land.
Oh, aww. yes.
It's something that the kids and their dad came up with. And
I will never forget being at the mall with you and you being like, your dad's trying to think of like a good holiday for a kids section. And I was like, duh, birthday. And I called him. Like, she was like, call him then, because that's what I've been saying.
But let's be real. Our dad didn't like to listen to our suggestions.
No, but he did like Birthday Land.
Yeah, he did.
He did like it. And I think had he lived, we probably would have done that within a few years. Mm-hmm.
It's still not off the docket. It's still, you know, we're still, it's still in the mix of things.
Still in possibilities of master planning.
Yeah.
So yeah, the kids come and they get to celebrate their birthday every day.
Yeah.
I think it's a brilliant idea.
Yeah.
And we could have a theater in the shape of a birthday cake.
Yes.
Every section has a theater.
We could have a gift shop in the shape of a birthday cake. A in the shape of a birthday cake. I mean, there's so many possibilities.
There is.
Right?
Like a giant pinata for a store.
That would be great.
Oh, yeah. You walk into the pinata and it's full.
It's a candy store.
Merchandise.
That's shaped like a pinata.
Yes.
Candy stores do really well, too. So it's a good business
move. I love candy stores. I used to go to IAPA and just pick up candy.
Yeah?
Yeah. I tried to get them to sell it for years. I was like, oh, do this. And now you're doing it. So I think I was just way ahead of my time.
The candy.
I'm just like picturing like a spinning coaster, like cute little size, not like anything like giant, but like cupcake-shaped cars.
Ooh. That's cute.
I'm like a cake-shaped carousel.
Ooh.
David.
So many good ideas.
Or like just a unicorn carousel.
Can we get Van Perla in here? And
Draw it up, everybody. Listeners, I expect renderings by the next episode.
Yes. A carousel of unicorns and dragons.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. You got to think of, yeah.
Because you got to think of like boys, too.
Like piratey things and, you know, just kind of like every theme. Mm-hmm. But like it'd be kind of fun to like... I don't know. Do something like so that's fun. Every birthday theme, like popular birthday theme in one without
that's it, a lot.
Without licensing. Crossing all the licensing.
Yeah.
You have to go. Y'all, for like... we're a family park. We don't have that kind of money.
But we're creative.
I know. You can tell just by like us starting in that we're like, oh yeah, we're
yes.
Well, a lot of it would be centered like around our characters too.
Yeah.
Oh, 100%.
Oh yeah. Maybe that would be when we add a new character.
Uh-huh. What a great idea.
Maybe we could have like a little unicorn. It was a girl because we don't have enough girl characters.
We need another girl.
It's fine.
We do.
Kitty sells almost, I mean, some is better than Holodog does.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. She's popular.
She's very popular.
I mean, people love Kitty Claus.
George and Sam, man.
We love Kitty.
They don't get the love they deserve.
No, this that's is all true. I know. Yeah. I love all of them.
We're actually here to not discuss this, believe it or not.
That was fun, though.
Yeah.
I love, this is why I like this icebreaker question, because it gets everyone kind of thinking about things, and Sabrina has one that she commits to of like an indoor flume that's very themed. I love that.
Oh, yes.
So, you know, we'll get around to all of these at some point.
It's just time and money.
Time and money, as Matt says. That's the VP of operations for you. So first of all, I want to start by talking about our entertainment department, and specifically, we have a performer, Kelsie Watts, who is on The Voice right now.
Is that the chair sound? Is that the exact sound that when their chair
sounds? Was that supposed to be like an air horn?
Yes.
So yes, I specifically want Sandy and Mom to tell the story of where you were when you first heard Kelsie singing on TV. Was it just last week?
Two weeks ago.
2 weeks ago. Go.
I was so excited. I was about ready to wet myself. I called Lauren, and Lauren goes, we're watching. We're on.
Well, we're watching, but like 30 minutes behind.
So I thought, Sandy's got to do this, surely. And I called her, and she was in her car. I could tell she was on speakerphone. And I thought, oh my gosh, she doesn't get to hear this. Sandy, do you want me to put this? Do you want me to turn this on speakerphone so you can hear too?
No.
She was, yeah, sure. Aww.
So we listened together.
Oh, that's awesome.
But what I love about that story, though, is I feel like it just is like an example of the way we support our performers. Like we're really excited for that. I know. Like I've been working on like a blog post about it, but I'm just like, I feel like we have so many performers and we're so happy when they come back. Like when we got, you know, Robert Sharkey was here for years and years and years. And every time we'd be like, yes, we got him.
Yes.
Yes. He's back. Yes. Yes. And then we finally got to a point where we're like, okay, you got to do better things than us. Like,
we love you dearly and we don't want you to go, but we do.
But we want to see you
better
grow.
Things out
He's made for so much more than Holiday World. And so that's part of the fun for us is getting to see these performers when they come across our stage. A lot of them, this is their first paid performing gig. A lot of them, this is kind of like, this is early for them in their career. And it's so much fun to see where they're going to go mm-hmm. and like watch them where they go. I'm just,
well, even yeah. how they progress over the summer, they're with us.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Because they really do learn a lot about performing. Mm-hmm. Even when you have to do show, so many shows a day, so many shows a week, you learn a lot about yourself mm-hmm. and how, mm-hmm. what your stamina is and mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. learning how to act.
Or for
because
me,
you
learning.
Can't just yeah.
stand and sing.
Phone yeah. it in. Yeah. yeah. You can't just phone yeah. it in.
You can tell when, yeah. But yeah, you learn so much about, I'm trying to like, yeah, you learn a lot about yourself when you perform in a theme park, especially. I feel like you learn, how do I put this? You learn how to adapt quickly.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
There was the show where I was the only female with a costume.
Oh God.
There was a country show where we went in for the costume change and the zippers on the dresses for both other girls broke.
Blew out, yeah.
Oh, no.
So I went out and took the solo. And all the guys were trying to help. So there's two guys backstage. One guy singing a solo that normally is like a big dance number. And I I'm the only one who's ready. And so I'm like ready to start dancing with my partner. My partner's not there. And so there's normally like one girl in this number that just like grooves because it's like a very partner heavy dance. So I just like was in the background like I was like, okay, at any point they're going to come out and they're going to start dancing.
You need to know this is a three-girl, three-boy show. Yeah. So
there's literally one girl, one boy
yeah. on stage.
So like I just sit out there like looking like an idiot doing this little like lame dance in the
snapping
background
her fingers.
While this guy is like trying to like sell this number as just a me singing a solo that normally has a lot of dance behind it. And I go back to the back of the stage because I'm like, okay, well, you know, I clear out for this number, you know, the next soloist comes on and starts singing. I will never forget Hanson Hostetler was backstage and goes, oh, you're singing this, honey. We were both young. I was like, okay, all right.
Did I hear a little Jennifer Nettles coming out there?
No. Okay. Taylor Swift.
Yeah, that's yeah, Taylor Swift.
Some T-Swifty.
Yeah. Well, we'll talk about the Jennifer Nettles impression some other day. But no, I just feel like, yeah, there are so many things
adapting.
That you...
Adapting.
But yeah, so we get to watch these performers. My performing days are long past, I pray.
Seriously. I pray
we
too.
Get to watch them. Yeah. We've occasionally gotten pulled into Halloween
we've
shows.
We've both been on this stage more recently than we cared.
Yeah. We've created a Halloween show at one point. And
which we were both in.
Filled in for people as needed. Good times. But you know, it's so much more fun, I feel like, to sit and like, to watch the performers as they grow throughout the summer and all of that. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm so excited for Kelsie right now. What do you guys like? I want to preface our conversation with Kelsie in that like during rehearsals, she had a family emergency that like by all means, as far as I was concerned, she shouldn't have come back. Like it was.
Absolutely.
We should have been. Yeah,
and she was given, I mean, yeah. she was given that. I didn't, you know, option. That option yes. right yeah. away. But she did go home. And I think that I think she needed to deal with everything in the way she needed to deal with it. And she did come back and, mm-hmm. and
she came back
hard
like within like a week uh-huh. and a half.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And it worked almost the whole summer.
Yeah.
Just to be clear, not our story to tell. We're not going to tell it. We're not giving that away. But like, she.
But what a great, amazing person.
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
I know a lot of really talented people, mm-hmm. but when they're deep down amazing,
yeah,
you mm-hmm. know, yeah. it makes you really happy to see them succeed.
Yeah,
absolutely. Yes.
Sometimes people succeed and you're like, yeah, and they're really not very nice.
Yeah.
But she's wow.
Yeah. She's the real deal.
Yep.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Inside and out.
Yes.
I mean,
And that's with the voice, you just are never sure if they're going to get a chance to see all that, you know, like you're like, I mean,
can we just discuss the stress of watching most of that number go, like most of her song go by and none of the judges hitting a button?
I know. Yeah.
She was doing amazing.
Suspenseful.
So we'll post a, like embed the video in the blog post that goes with this, but like, basically, she made it through almost the entire number and threw in some amazing like whistle tones, mm-hmm. which if you don't know what whistle tones are, think Whitney Houston. Mm-hmm. Like just those ridiculously high notes that mm-hmm. you're like, no human hits those for real. And she came in with some strong whistle tones, and both Kelly and Gwen finally hit the button.
Well, I think they were all just waiting at first because it was Kelly's song.
Yeah.
Yes.
They're
all
like, oh, yes. She sang a Kelly Clarkson song in front of Kelly Clarkson. And Kelly said, she doesn't normally turn her chair for that.
And I think they were waiting. Yeah. I think the rest of them were waiting to see if she would turn.
Yeah.
Because they knew how awesome it was.
Yeah.
And they're just waiting to see what she's going to do.
Because Gwen was right behind Kelly.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But yeah, once those high notes came in, they were like, oh, like, no brainer, got it.
Yeah.
In fact, I included like a little picture today. MSN wrote an article about Kelsey, and they had, what was it, the top 10 best blind auditions of The Voice this season, and Kelsey was number 4.
That is amazing.
Awesome.
I'm so excited for her. I know. I hope that, I hope she makes it far.
Yes.
Even if she doesn't, though, I feel like the coaching and the attention mm-hmm. she's getting, like, everyone go follow her. She's just an amazing human. Go find all of her social media accounts. Mm-hmm. But I also want to talk about how, like, this crew specifically, how we show up. Because I want to, like, I'm trying to, like, think of, like, a nice way to put it. But, like, for Rayvon...
Hashtag vote Rayvon or save Rayvon.
Save
Rayvon.
We like created our own Twitter accounts because none of us had them.
I know.
Only time I've ever used my Twitter account.
How do I do a Twitter?
We're following Rayvon. He's like, you're going to need to post like hashtag save Rayvon. Like, you know, like I think it looks like I might be in the bottom. Mm-hmm. You'll need to do this. And everyone like immediately went like, save Rayvon.
Yeah.
And he was like, not yet. Calm down. But like, every episode, Rayvon was in the bottom too. It was the first year that they had done a Twitter save.
Yes.
And we saved him every time. And I like to think that, we had Holiday World tweeting. We had everyone. And
the
we
entire had high school. Yeah. I would be like, it'd be on the board for the kids.
Yeah.
Save Rayvon. Oh.
Save Rayvon. Yeah.
Be like, yes. Extra credit. Save
it's
Rayvon.
Tonight, guys.
But yeah. So it was just kind of like, I don't even know how you would count that like with Twitter, but we showed up and like when the American Idol tour came through town, we showed up for that.
We sure did.
And like, we will take trips to New York. What were you going to say?
I was just, it's just part of the culture of working at Holiday World. You know, I tell the kids every year at Christmas in July, I'm like, this is a different family than you will ever have anywhere else. Mm-hmm. And they will mean the world to you. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, just like this past year, we had one of our young ladies, her mother passed with COVID. Mm-hmm. And everyone that worked with her immediately was on, what are we doing?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so we immediately, you know, everybody was praying for her all along. And then when she did pass, we were all like, what can we do to help her get through this? Mm-hmm. And I mean, it's just a different family. It's a family and we are there because they're family, you know, they're my kids.
Yeah.
We're going to do what we need to do to help them out or.
Well, you know, I think the summer is always a little bit more intense for performers because they live together. So they live together, they work together.
Yes, they're never apart from each other.
They're never apart from each other. And so there's a lot of big emotions that come out of that summer. There's a lot of deep friendships that are forged. There's a lot of sometimes relationships that are made. Occasionally relationships that are broken. But you know, there's so much that happens in that summer, but it's so crazy to me because I see people like on Facebook who performed in different seasons, even who know each other.
Yes.
And and I'm like, okay, maybe they knew each other from somewhere.
No, they just
know each other. Cause they worked in Holiday World.
They were Holiday World kids. Yeah.
They got connected somehow. And
I'll like
friends.
Post like, on, what? They'll have a post and somebody will ever respond. And I'm like, my kids. And they're like, yeah, we're both your kids.
So, I
think some of them sometimes just bond over you, Sandy. I think sometimes they're like, you know Sandy too? Okay, we're friends.
I love them so much.
But yeah, and I'm trying to think, I mean, like, We could sit here and list all the people. Like we never did a podcast episode for Chris.
Right.
Oh, and Sweet Magnolias.
Yeah.
So
what
Chris,
a great kid.
I love Chris so much.
Yes.
What a great show too.
Yes. You know, it's not very
cannot
often.
Wait for season two.
You watch a show like, I watch a show and I have a young teenage daughter, you know, very young teenage, bottom of the teenage, just got here. Honestly say, yes, you can watch this.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I love that about Chris's show. You know, Alicia watches it and, you know, she's like, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's also just the moment, and I know, like, Mom, you probably experienced it a lot, because Jeff was on an extra on a lot of things out in L.A.?
My friend Jeff Hudson, he performed with me back in 84, and I remember sitting with my mom watching The Love Boat, and it was like, there he goes, he's behind the pool.
And Matt can attest that that is exactly how I watch TV when I know someone that I love is coming up. Like,
when Kelsie came out, he said, oh my God, there's Kelsie.
No, I literally went, oh my God. Like, it was not like that. It was like high pitched. Yeah. It was obnoxious. I feel like if he had been holding something, he would have dropped
it. And I was like over there on my iPad, you know, just like, it was startling.
I was a little high strung when I called Sandy. Was
The call I got was...
Yeah.
It was special. Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, and like same thing with Chris. Like when I started watching Sweet Magnolias, I knew he was in it, but I still, the second I finally saw him, I was like, I know him. That's what I keep doing. I share like Kelsie's stuff and I'm like, I know her. Like, I still can't believe it sometimes.
Oh, one of the girls that worked with me at the park years ago did some television spots. You know, she was in, Lopez show. Was it George Lopez show? And when I saw her, Lori and I both, we'd call each other. We're like, oh my gosh, did you see her? And then she was on Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Yeah.
She was the weird roommate and just like freak. But it's just neat when you see a lot of commercials. So when you see people that you've worked with or you've known, you're like, whoa.
Yeah. It's just so really cool to be, that we get to be so connected to the entertainment community.
Part of their story.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that's whatever you're doing, you know, like we're looking at it as like the famous whatever.
Yeah.
But, you know, like I'm so proud of you too. You know, like, I mean, it's just so neat to watch people grow and become who they are. And tear up the world, you know, it's just, it's awesome. You know, like people are finding out how great you are. And I knew it when you were little, you know what I mean? And that's the really cool thing about this, you know, we're a theme park, a small theme park. So we're the starter point for them. Mm-hmm. And so these are the stepping stones. And, you know, you said they need to do something better than us, but they just need to do bigger. They're just moving, you know,
they're on their way somewhere.
This is where you start, you know, this is your summer gig and then you go to the full-time gig.
Yep.
Yeah. Ooh.
So it's really cool. You know, just to watch.
Yeah.
You see, all grow.
I won't forget, like Rave-On had already happened. And like, I would sit and just like watch Rave-On and just be like, I can't believe we know him and that he still acknowledges us, you know, he should be too cool for us.
He came to visit after he was on American Idol and he was like, hey guys, he's like, I'm coming. He's like, would it be okay if I like sang a song? We're like, what? You would do it?
Like, okay, at my house.
Reschedule the whole day. No shows, just Rave-On. We'll figure it out.
Rave-On was a part of like a magical cast too. Because Jordan and Felicia both came back too.
They were such a close-knit group.
Oh, they were so funny together too.
They were.
Rave-On and Jordan especially, they really fed off of each other. But no, I also like, I won't forget that like, we had gone and seen Chad Seib, who performed back in the day, like back when I was a kid in the shows, and we saw him in Mary Poppins, and like that was super cool to see. But I will not forget when I was in my MBA program and Jordan Wright was in Rent, and like I had like midterm study sessions every night. So it was only three nights and I'd missed the first two nights. And so I just like bought a ticket, had the midterm at night. And so I was like, I have no idea when I'm going to make it. And I managed to like run across campus as soon as the midterm was done, made it to the auditorium. They were like, deep into the first act. So like, I think intermission happened just like a couple minutes later. But I sat down, got settled in, and all of a sudden Jordan had a solo. Aww. And I was just like, I know him. He's doing things. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's just, it's, I don't know how to describe it, but yeah, when you get to
and
like,
they just stay who they are too, though.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean, like when we went to see Rent, I mean, Jordan met us and like, and it was just Jordan, you know? Yeah. And, you know, Chris was working on Broadway, I guess 2 years ago maybe. And Zach, my son, was in Secret Santa. He had one of the girls that loved Mean Girls. Mm-hmm. And so I like texted him, I'm like, hey, Chris, so what can you do for me? And he goes, got ya. He sent me a program signed by the entire cast for Zach to give to this little girl. I mean, it was the Broadway cast, all their signatures. And then he sends me one with just his signature in it for me. And I'm like, this is, nice. I mean, it's, he's the same person.
You know? I got to go see him in Mean Girls. And well, I actually didn't get to see him because he was the swing and was didn't get to go into that show. So
that was in previews and they don't put the swings in there.
But still, we like hung out afterwards and we're waiting at the door and he came out and I was like, will you sign my program? And he was like, you want me to sign that? I'm like, yes. Like, you're darn tootin'.
Yeah.
You're darn tootin'.
But yeah, I got the chance when I was up visiting William one time to like go actually see him perform in Mean Girls. And like, I like met him afterwards. Like we were texting the whole time. Cause I was like, okay, I want to be able to like see a show you're actually in. Like I want to support Mean Girls. Sure. But like, I want to see you. And like, it's so cool to see them. But yeah, I also made him sign my playbill and like took a picture with him. And then like, as soon as he got the Sharpie out, all these girls started like flocking to him because they're like, oh, you were in the show.
Yeah.
Like, I was just like, it was so fun to watch. And he was so just like, oh, sorry. I'm like, you're famous now. Yeah. I get it.
You're famous, but they're still, they're, you know, I mean, just like Nick Rashad's the same way. Like when I send, like any kind of congratulations or what on things that he's doing, he always responds back, hey mama, you know, and it's like, he's the same kid that worked here, you know, at 19 or whatever. They're just the same kids.
And Nick's done a lot.
Yeah. Nick has been in Something Rotten on tour.
Mm-hmm. Kinky Boots.
He was Lola.
The understudy for Lola.
He was one of the angels. He was in King Kong. Yeah. He's now rehearsing Diana.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Nice. He did, didn't he play Ike in something?
Tina Turner.
Yeah, in the Tina Turner.
Oh, sorry. Chris Medlin's in Diana.
Yes. Yeah.
Sorry.
Nixon.
Yeah. Nick. We can't keep our kids on Broadway straight.
They're just too successful.
Nick does some work with Todrick Hall.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Some of his videos.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
It's kind of cool.
Really cool.
I've seen Nick post things and it's like, I know what Todrick Hall's like personal Facebook account is. Because he's like tagged him in. I'm like, wow, I know who that is. I know how to find him. I'm not going to friend him because I'm not a weirdo.
But I really want to.
And I could. He wouldn't take it.
But I could.
But it's an option.
Oh my gosh.
Want to know a secret? The best time to buy season passes is always right now. It's that simple. We believe in transparent pricing, so there's no game to play and no complications. Prices increase throughout our off-season, so hurry and buy now. We have 3 different passes with different perks, so go to holidayworld.com/passes to pick the pass that fits your family best.
Want to make a suggestion or have questions for the Pod Squad? There are more ways than ever to reach out to the podcast.
Find @HolidayWorld on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and use the hashtag HOWOPO to let us know you're talking about us.
You can now call us. Dial 812-937-4401 and type in extension 8081 to get to the HOWOPO voicemail box.
Leave your questions and feedback for us there, or you can email us at podcast@holidayworld.com. Either with a written message or with a voice memo.
Again, Reach out on social media to @HolidayWorld and use the hashtag HoWoPo or call us at 812-937-4401, extension 8081, or send us an email to podcast@holidayworld.com. Now we've got a new concept coming your way. We're going to hear from some of our past performers, find out from them where they are, what their favorite memories are, and what they're doing today.
Hi, my name is Amanda Klass. My maiden name was Amanda Barnett, which is how I was known at Holiday World. I'm originally from Rockport, Indiana, but now I live in Bowling Green, Kentucky. And I worked at Holiday World from 2008 until 2018, off and on. I started out in the Holidazzles and the Gospel Show, and then I did pop for a couple of years before I moved on to doing solely country, which I think is what most people would remember me from. A couple of solos that I sang were Cowboy Casanova and Good Girl by Carrie Underwood. But I have to say that my favorite show to be in are the Halloween shows. I love the Halloween shows. And when it was lights out, I was the vampire magician the first year, and I was the ringmaster with purple hair the second year. And then most recently, I was in Come Alive, and I was the Frankenstein-like creature that came alive during the show. It's so hard to pick a specific memory to say that is my favorite because there are just so many. And to be totally honest, I can't say half of my favorite memories because although they are hilariously funny, they all would embarrass someone really terribly because it either had to do with someone falling on their face or someone rushing off to the bathroom mid-show and everyone having to figure out how to cover the show without them. And so I feel like I can't say those because that would be awful towards them. So I will just keep those to myself. But I think some of my favorite memories come from playing games during the shows. And I know that is so unprofessional to say, but it's just a fact of life. Entertainers play games during the shows that you watch, and I think one of my favorite games to play was the one where you couldn't look anybody in the eye. So on stage, you are looking at someone and you're singing a love song and you're supposed to be longingly gazing into their eyes, but in reality, you're looking at their nose. And it is so hard to keep a straight face, and I always loved those, and I'm a giggler, and it was always so hard to keep a straight face, but it was always so fun to play those. So now it's kind of something that I try to figure out when I go watch theme park shows. I'm like, are they playing a game? I wonder if they're passing the penny, or I wonder if they're not looking at each other really right now. So I think some of my favorite memories come from that because you are, you know, doing this show so many times a day, and you're trying to keep it genuine, and you're trying to keep it real, and so you kind of have to find ways to make the show super fun again undercover so that everybody else is enjoying the same show that they always enjoy, but you are having a new experience. And to kind of tag along with that, I think that is honestly one of the biggest lessons that I learned from live performance is to be genuine. And I know that probably seems kind of like a random thing to learn from live performance, but I think that doing meet and greets after the show and going out and meeting the guests and seeing how excited all the little kids were to come and take pictures with you and to meet you. And I honestly am still friends with several families that I met at Holiday World, and I'm so grateful to them and their friendship and support throughout the years. And so I feel like working at Holiday World just really taught me how important it is to be intentional with how you show people that you care and how important it is to be genuine in how you treat people and to show them how grateful you are that they spent time and took time out of their day to come and spend it with you and watch your show. And so I've tried to carry that throughout my daily life to continue being genuine and intentional with the people I meet every day. Since working at Holiday World, I have sang on a cruise ship. I did a Christmas contract at a different theme park, and I've also done a few contracts up at a theater in French Lick, Indiana. Not performing wise, I was an online English teacher, actually, for 3.5 years, and I taught English to Chinese children. And most recently, and what I am most excited about, is that I have launched my own travel company. After working on the cruise ship and seeing 25 countries, I just knew that traveling was my second love, and I wanted to keep doing it, and I wanted to show other people what was out there and help them experience what I had experienced. And I'm under the belief that people know what they want out of traveling, and they know how they want to feel when they go on vacation, but they don't always know how to get there. And so I wanted to create a company that would help them cross that middle ground and to help them go get them, which is where the company name comes from. And so Go Get Them is a travel coach, and we learn about the individual's interests in order to create a unique and perfect fit kind of trip for each person. You can find us on Instagram at gogetem_travel. That's gogetem_travel. And you can also find us online at gogetemtravel.com, where you can follow along with other people's adventures. You can see places that you should travel to, and you can also take a quiz and find out what your personal vacation should be. And I would absolutely love your support in this new venture. And if you follow us on Instagram and comment and tell us, hey, I'm a Holiday World person, we would absolutely love that. We love Holiday World. We will always love Holiday World and highly, highly, highly recommend it.
Hello, Holiday World family. My name is Carson. I'm from Asheville, North Carolina. I was a performer at Holiday World in 2009 and 2011. And, you know, it's probably two of the best summers of my entire life. The majority of the people that I met while I was there, I'm still extremely close with. But even more than that, I have a second family with my Holiday World family, from Sandy Fortune, who is the director of entertainment, and of course the Cook family. William Cook was like a second dad to me. Lori, of course, is like my second mom. And then Leah and of course Lauren are like my sisters, and William Jr., of course, like my brother. I even sang at Lauren's wedding, which was one of the most special things that I've ever done, and I was so excited to be asked. What I liked the most about Holiday World Entertainment was the fact that it wasn't just a job. It wasn't just performing. It really was a family. I mean, we lived together. We worked together. We did everything together. We had Christmas in July, when Sandy would call all of our parents behind our backs and get our favorite recipes for Christmas dinner and make them for us to have a huge Christmas party. And that was always amazing. One of my favorite memories that I had in the park during the season, we used to do food tours, Holiday World food tours. We called it the Ho-Wo food tour. And we would go to every single part of the park and get a different food from every part of the park all in one day during our breaks. And that was fun. But one of my best memories of Holiday World was actually in 2011. I played Scratch in Vinyl Days. And that part was so much fun to play, but also during rehearsals, I twisted my knee and actually dislocated it. And there was a guy named Greg Woodruff, we call him Pookie, and he ran literally jumping over fences and everything to get to me. And he was actually able to put my knee back in place. And I just watched as my entire Holiday World family surrounded me, and they were praying for me and they were worried about me. And then Lori Cook actually went with me to the emergency room. And I remember I was so doped up on morphine because of the pain, and I was playing Angry Birds on my phone, and Lori will never let me live this down. She looked at me and she goes, "Why are you laughing?" And I said, "I just don't understand why these birds are so angry." So that's just a few of my favorite memories. Since then, I've been out on the high seas as a cruise director for a couple of different cruise companies. I currently work for Oceana Cruises for the past 3 years and kind of found a home there. I love, love, love being a part of that company. It's literally the highlight of my career so far outside of Holiday World. to be able to be in charge of all of entertainment. And it was really actually Sandy Fortune that kind of pushed me in the direction of cruise ships. And now I am kind of like she was. I have a staff of 40 people and I'm in charge of everything that happens on board entertainment wise. And it's just a really awesome thing. So if you ever get the chance, come and sail with me on Oceana Cruises. As far as, you know, support for me right now, I mean, you know, of course, with this situation and cruising being stalled, like, things have been really difficult, especially financially, but, you know, I'm getting through it one day at a time. I guess the best thing that I can say is support your local arts. The local arts are so important, and especially during this time, we're seeing so many theaters close and so many things happen, and it's just a really scary time for the arts. So just support your local arts. And something I've learned about live entertainment that I've kept with me is every single person who wants to be a performer should do a theme park because you will never build the stamina and performance level that you need without a theme park. I can honestly tell you, when you have to wear a full cowboy outfit, cowboy boots, hat, everything, and do Devil Went Down to Georgia at the end of a 45-minute show where you are hoofing it and kicking yourself in the face, and it is 100 degrees outside, trust me, you are building that stamina. And then you get like 30 minutes off, and then you got to do the pop show. And then, I mean, it's just, it's hard work, but it's so worth it, and it really builds something in you as a performer. I just want to let everybody out there know that Holiday World is extremely special to me. The Cook family is extremely special to me. The Fortune family is extremely special to me. Matt Eckert and his family are extremely special to me. And I am so happy to have been a part of that world and to be a part of the Holiday World family.
Hi, my name is Jeff Hudson, and I was a singer at Holiday World. Its very first year as Holiday World in 1984, transitioning from Santa Claus Land. And it was really my first big professional job, and I have such great memories of it. I'm from Indianapolis, Indiana, originally, but I live in Las Vegas now. And I was in the show On Broadway, as well as the show I Love Country Music. And, you know, it all began there in Holiday World for me. And what I learned at Holiday World, I have carried with me throughout my career that I'm still working in. I learned that customer service is everything. And no matter what you do, you're in customer service. And you really need to do everything you can to make sure that the customer has an amazing time. And I've always taken that with me everywhere I've gone. And the other thing that I learned at Holiday World is just give your all. Give your heart, your soul, all of it to the moment. And make sure that you're doing your very best. And the audience gives back to you in return. And that has really helped me throughout my career. What am I doing now? Well, I perform still in Las Vegas. I perform on the American Queen Steamboat Company on board the Duchess, the American Duchess. And I also own a gondola ride in Indianapolis called Old World Gondoliers. And that's open from May through the beginning of October. And all of our operators sing in Italian and they do traditional gondola rides. And you can bring your own beverages on board. And that's in Indianapolis. And we've been doing that for 20 years. But I still sing and I still love it and I never plan on retiring. I'm 55 years old now and I'm still going, still doing it, and I still love it. And I still keep in contact with my castmates and we still have reunions and get together. And it's part of family. You know, you pick up people along the way that become part of your family and part of your core values and that you really learn from. And I learned so much from all the people that I worked with at Holiday World, and they're in my life today.
Hey, y'all, it's Jessie C-Mac. Most of you guys would have known me as Jessie Woodruff. I was a performer at Holiday World in 2010 and 11 and 2010. I was in Vinyl Days as the character Izzy, and in Rejoice, one of the songs that Amy Farrell and I used to sing was How Great Thou Art. In 2011, I did the country show. Because of Holiday World, it changed my life. I met my husband at Holiday World, and we have two beautiful little girls. My oldest daughter's name is Indiana because that's where he and I met. And we have a beautiful life in Charlotte, North Carolina. I am a stay-at-home mom, but I do travel agent work on the side. It's just kind of a fun hobby of mine. If you'd like to follow along, you can follow me at fb.me/JessieDoesDisneyAndMore. Our family loves Disney, and we love to travel. When I think about my time at Holiday World, all I have is positive feelings. We had so much fun together. Our casts were amazing. We all lived in the same big house, so, you know, it was always chaotic and crazy, but I've made some of my best friends there, and again, I met my husband there. If it hadn't been for Holiday World, I wouldn't be where I am today.
Hey guys, it's JT here, and I'm currently hiding out in Evansville, Indiana. I've been a part of the Dive Show for about approximately 11 years, including this most recent year with its reduced season. I've been the man out in the audience, and the high diver, and almost everything in between. And currently, I am the front of house manager at Primetime Pub and Grill in Newburgh. It's a pretty nice place. So one of my favorite memories at Holiday World was watching my coworkers overcome their fears and their shortcomings and taking that leap of faith from 70 feet in the air for the first time. When they pop back out of the water, man, that reaction is just heartwarming. That's a little different for every person. Something I've really learned from my time with live entertainment, there's two things really. So the first is that you really get out of a job what you put in. So the more effort and the more energy you put into work, the more rewarding it becomes. I've also learned that it really isn't the task or the job or the description or the day-to-day work that makes work awesome or awful. It's really the people that you work with. So when I work my other jobs, my current job, I frequently ask myself, am I being a pain or a pleasure to work with? And if you really are interested, I am currently working towards creating my own business. I want to open my own miniature golf course in the Evansville, Newburgh area. I hope you guys are doing well, and maybe I'll see you in the near future.
My name is Stacy Hurst. I was a member of Country Gold and sing our songs America back in 1990. My maiden name is Stacy Berger. I had a few solos. My two favorites were in the Country Gold song Paper Roses, which was my grandfather's favorite song. So when I was chosen to do that solo, I was extremely excited. My grandfather had the beginning stages of Alzheimer's, and the first time he came to the show and saw me singing that song, he broke into tears. So that's probably one of my most cherished memories. I also can say that the friends that I made that summer are lifetime friends. One was in my wedding, another one, and I still get together on a regular basis. And I do have an acoustic partner. His name is John Vaughn, and we go by John and Stacy. And we do Facebook Live currently, since we're not able to play in some of the venues that we had been playing. We both do a lot in our community. We live in Jasper, in regards to donating our time and talents to different fundraising events. We will be doing a telethon on WBDC on December 5th. We do have a Facebook page. It's John, J-O-N, and Stacy, S-T-A-C-E-Y. So you can like our page and share some of our music in our posts. We do post original videos from every time to time, so have a blessed day.
Hello, this is Trevor May from Southern Illinois, a small town called Dundas, about 4 hours door-to-door from Holiday World and Splashin' Safari. I was a seasonal entertainer at the park from the years 2012 until 2015. And when I think back to that, I can remember the very first time I went to the park to audition. I was a high schooler. I hadn't even gotten my driver's license. My mother had to drive me to the audition. And it was a great experience. And I was hired as a main stage performer. But little did I know that I was going to have to get a work permit and finally take my driving test so I could actually drive to work. Crazy times in the world. So I was in shows, Rejoice, the gospel show at the park. I always called myself the chief handshaker because I loved going out and shaking the audience's hands. I was in the Legacy Singers, where I was commonly the bass singer in the morning, but the tenor singer in the afternoon. And then, during Happy Halloween Weekends, I was in the Graveyard Smash Show as the Gravedigger. I think that's probably my most notorious role. I had a lot of fun with that and really enjoyed some of those costumes too. And then I ended up with World of Wonder, wow, as the Ringmaster, and still have some phenomenal, phenomenal relationships from not only that show, but from many of the experiences at Holiday World. So one of my biggest memories at the park was really the first place that I felt as a home away from home, where I could be myself, truly, and learn so much about so many facets of professionalism that really helped to propel me in my career. I can look back and think about some really interesting situations and takeaways from the park, and it's all due to some really early on formative experience. So these days, what am I up to now? I finished my MBA and have launched into the world of business as a strategy consultant, and have been working across the US, innovating and helping my clients grow their businesses. And when I'm not working, typically 10 to 12 hours a day, I have some hobbies like running political election campaigns and raising money for food insecurity. And I also am in this rather intriguing project. I am building a tiny vacation home. I'm sure you all have possibly seen a tiny home or seen something on Instagram about a tiny home, but I thought I wanted one for myself and one that I could travel in seasonally to see the US. So I'm building a tiny vacation home. Little did you know that I could sing and dance on a good day, but I can also wield a hammer. Fun fact. And one of the other things that Leah asked when we were thinking about this podcast was support. How can we support entertainers that may not be performing right now? And while I don't have a direct answer, because I'm not directly involved in the entertainment business anymore, I do play an indirect role with many of my past colleagues. And I think it's important to just think about what life would be like without entertainment. I think it's paramount that the community of patrons, which we all gain membership to, you know, just by watching any form of entertainment, anywhere, in any medium. I think it often gets lost on folks that these creatives are professionals in the truest sense. While they may not have an MBA, like the banker who gave you a home mortgage, they are the lifeblood of society, of community, of culture, and quality of life. And just like the driver that you may call from Lyft or Uber to pick you up from the airport when you're headed to Holiday World or some other destination vacation, we would have a much different world without them. And I think these artists are the folks who make us laugh, help us cry, and inspire us to get out of bed in the morning. So all of that to say, make sure you value their work and their craft just as much as you value that mortgage you might have on your home. And how can we do this? I think it's some simple things, like not taking a phone call or answering a text during a performance. And also, when you're in the hospitality setting, paying for service and tipping performers appropriately, just like you would your server, is a great thing to do because they're part of the system and they're part of the solution to, you know, having a good quality of life. So I think keeping that in mind is the best way to support performers at this time. The last piece here, what have I learned from being in shows over years at Holiday World? Well, I think the biggest central takeaway is that the show must go on. And I have applied that to my life in many ways ever since I left the stage at Holiday World. Sure, I don't have to sing and dance and do cardio for 2+ hours a day while smiling or wearing long sleeves in 90 degree weather, but we don't get to collectively hit a pause button in our life. We have to stay in the moment. We have to trust ourselves to make the best possible decision at each new turn. And I really think that's my biggest takeaway from being at the park. I can remember times when guests would walk up to me and say, where's this? And help, I need this, or XYZ. And we just always listened. We had a level head. We gave great answers. And we also helped them solve their problems and make sure that they could get back to their great day. And so I think that that's been one of the biggest takeaways, you know, how to work with people and make sure that the show can truly go on. So all of this to say thank you to my Holiday World alumni family. While we may be miles apart, we are very close in heart, and I would not be half the person I am without all of you in my life. And thanks to Holiday World and Splash and Safari, where they are still number one for family fun. Take care.
Congratulations, you've skrelted your way to the end of another episode.
No. Sorry.
That was another performer reference. Brian Brammer was the king of the skrelt.
Sweet little yes.
Where he could belt and like... It was like almost screaming, but like good for somehow not bad for his voice.
And he would skrull. Yeah. He used to skrull every day in the Finding Nemo musical at Animal Kingdom.
Yes.
But right now,
that yes. is
not in existence. Yeah. So sad
yeah.
day.
It'll be back. It'll be back. But yeah. Anyway, you've skrulled your way to the end of another episode. Please join us in 2 weeks during your next commute, cleaning session, etc. for our next episode, season 2, episode 26, the one where we deliver. Thank you to all our behind-the-scenes pod squad. Steven for putting up with me when I told you a lot of performers may be overwhelming our inbox. Josh for smartly telling us to get started at 1 o'clock today. We're already behind. And Sabrina for finding a man lift. It's a long story we'll tell another day. And thanks to all of you for continuing to listen. Please subscribe and leave a review on iTunes, Spotify, and Amazon Music, plus anywhere else you get your podcasts. And don't forget to tell all your friends. On behalf of today's pod squad, thank you. Please be sure to share your feedback and questions with us by calling us at 812-937-4401, then dial 8081, or by emailing us at podcast@holidayworld.com, or by reaching out to us on social media using the hashtag
HOWOPO.
You've been listening to the official Holiday World Podcast.
Welcome back. Did you enjoy your flight?
A production of Holiday World and Splash and Safari in Santa Claus, Indiana. Check out the latest episodes at holidayworld.com/podcast. Thanks for taking a ride with us.
And please come back to see us again soon.
Summer may feel far away, but it'll be here before we know it. With our Any Day tickets, you have the flexibility to visit any day of our 2021 season. Any Day tickets are on sale now, and this year, just like season passes, the best time to buy is always now. Go to holidayworld.com/tickets to buy.
Hello, this is Trevor May, and you're listening to the official Holiday World Podcast.